Thanks for joining us at Church Experience Online. If you'd like to learn more about the church, get connected to our community, or help fuel the movement by giving, just check out the link to our website in the description below.
Jesus calls us to live an abundant life following Him. And here at Church Experience, we believe there are seven areas where we can spiritually grow in order to live that life. To experience worship, weekly attend worship services with Church Experience. To experience grace, make a commitment to Jesus Christ, learn biblical beliefs, and be baptized. To experience growth, daily invest in personal time with God and keep growing. To experience relationships, develop healthy relationships, and get connected in a life group. To experience serving, live selflessly for others and participate on a serving team. To experience health, honor God in fitness, finances, and fun. To experience mission, invest in relationships with spiritually lost people, invite them to Church Experience, and influence your world. And as we grow in these growth steps, we live the abundant life that Jesus has called us to.
Experiencing growth, daily investing in time alone with God, and keep growing. That's so important. In fact, that growth step, it's in your notes, and it's central to our relationship with God. In fact, if there's something going wrong in your life and you just feel like things are just not right, there's a great chance that if you were to spend some time figuring this part of your life out, that it will change the rest of your life. Let me say it again. Experience growth, daily invest in personal time with God, and keep growing. It's an important growth step. You know, I think of this growth step, I think of our palm trees icon. And I love palm trees, and I don't know what it is about palm trees that I love. I just always have loved them. I feel like I'm on vacation when I look at a palm tree for some reason. It might be because when I grew up, my mom is from California, and we would travel from the Midwest. We would drive out with our family to California every other year to see all the cousins and all that. And so maybe it was from then. Maybe it was a couple trips that I took in high school from the Midwest down here to Florida and seeing the palm trees. I don't know what it is, but I always have loved them. So much so that when Jennifer and I finished school and we moved to the Washington, D.C. area, we both got some good jobs, and we were looking around for a place to purchase our first home, and we went to our realtor, and they said, man, this is a hot market right now in Washington, D.C., and we want to get a little townhouse, and they said, you know, you're going to be lucky if you can find something, and there was like one available on the day that we went out with our realtor the first time. They said, there's just one house available, one townhouse available, and we went in our little community there outside of town, we went to that townhouse, and while we're literally walking through this townhouse, this three-story townhouse, another family with their realtor pulled into the driveway to look at that same townhouse. So we looked at the realtor like, we'll take it. It's like, we'll take it. It's the only one available. We'll take it. And we enjoy that little home. But in that home, it had a backyard, which I'm thankful now. My yard takes a little more time to mow, but I'm thankful for that yard because it was so easy to mow because it was like the size of a couple parking spaces. You know, it was a really small yard. And you could literally almost mow the yard from inside the house. Like if you just lean, you could almost mow it. But I love palm trees so much at that point in my life. Even though we lived in a climate where palm trees don't grow, I went out and I found a couple palm tree-looking plants, and I went in the backyard, and in each corner, I planted a little palm tree-type plant. I was so excited about these palm trees that I planted them in my yard, and I've always loved it. And I wanted to show you those pictures of those palm trees in the backyard as I thought of that. And I found in our family photos, I found in the archives, I found not only those pictures, but pictures of our home. And it was funny to me because I looked through them just for memory's sake, and I started noticing. I'm like, I really did love palm trees. In our living room, there's like a fake palm tree, right? And then I looked in our bedroom, and like on the wall, this is like over 10 years ago. There's like palm trees hanging on the wall. Our little kitchen, we didn't have kids or anything at that point, just us. Like their little tomato soup grilled cheese meal you can see there. There's palm trees on the wall, like everywhere. I'm like, I just must have loved palm trees. And I don't think it's just that they're beautiful, and they still are to me after living here in Florida for some time now. They're beautiful to me. But it's not just that. Like, the palm tree represents something having to do with this idea of growing in our relationship with God. It's very explicitly in the Bible. Psalm chapter 92, I love this, verse 12. It says, "The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like a cedar of Lebanon. Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green." I love that. The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. Now you can just tell your friends and family that live elsewhere that it's biblical to live here in Florida, like to be around the palm trees. Man, it's so good, though. I love this concept that they thrive, they grow, the righteous. Like, and I believe this is so true. God, listen, God honors those who honor him. And the righteous, their lives, they thrive. And it doesn't always look how you imagine, but like they're healthy, they're green. And yeah, that means physically we're all going to waste away at some point, but they're healthy. Like, and who they are, like their lives, and they're fresh. It says they'll bear fruit in old age. Like, there's something about that concept of growing and the righteous growing. And in fact, it's all throughout the Bible. In the New Testament, in Colossians chapter 2, verse 6, it says, "So then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him." Listen to this. "Rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness." See, there's the concept again. Like, the righteous, those who are following Christ, they're rooted in Christ. Just in the same way that a plant or tree is growing roots, it's you're growing in your faith. You're being built up. We're being strengthened. We stay fresh and vibrant in our relationship with God. This concept of growing is all throughout the Bible. And so the palm tree reminds me, this icon reminds me that we should be continually growing and staying fresh in our relationship with God. And you know, healthy things generally, if you see something in nature that's green, generally it's healthy. And healthy things over time grow. And it's God's intention for us to grow in our relationship with God. But we should always be growing in more than one facet of our lives. Just like a plant, for a palm tree, for example. Simultaneously, it is growing under the ground that you can't see. The root system is expanding and growing. While at the same time, the branches are expanding and growing. So there's multiple facets of growth in a plant in nature and how God created it. It's the unseen under the soil. And then there's what you do see when you look at it above the soil. And here's the lesson in your notes. Is the reality is that you and I need to be growing in two different types of ways. One is the unseen spiritual and character growth that's evident to God who sees our heart. So God sees our heart, and there's this unseen spiritual and character growth that's happening inside of you as you're growing closer to God. And that should be happening. Is that happening in your heart, in your character? Are you changing to be more like Jesus? The unseen, not what we see, but what only God sees in your heart, is that growing? That should always be true, and that's kind of like the root system of your life that supports you when the hurricane force winds blow. But then there's also this, number two, there's the observed lifestyle growth that's evident to others as they see our actions. There's the exterior and the interior, and the exterior is this lifestyle, like how we live and how we honor God and the things we do, the actions that we take, the words that we speak. As others look at your life, they should see growth in that area over time because they watch your life. So there's both the unseen under the surface in your life, the character and spiritual growth. How's that coming? And then there should be the exterior, like the signs of that interior health in your life. Other people should look at you over a period of time and they should see progress. As you look in the mirror, you should feel good. Like, I'm not yet who I want to be, but I'm no longer who I used to be. Like, there's this growth, there's this change. And that progress, that growth in your life honors God. And we should never stop growing. In fact, in the Bible, it's expected that we grow and that we pursue growth. And it's kind of weird if you stop growing. Right? I mean, think about it. In like the human body even, isn't it? Wouldn't it be kind of weird if like we stopped growing physically, yet we still continued to age and our minds aged? Like, how weird would that be if like you have a baby that grew up into an adult, but their body always remained as a baby? It would probably look something like this.
the lyrical gangsta. Big up the crew in the area. Still love you like that, that. No, no, we don't die. Yes, we multiply. Anyone press, we hear the fire sing. Act like you know we go. I know what both don't know. Let's them up and go. Pick up the crew in the area. Still love you like that. Here come the observer. I'm the lyrical gangster. Excuse me, Mr. Officer.
And you know, that's funny because it doesn't actually happen, right? I mean, like when you grow, when you mature in age, your body grows with you. It would be weird if that didn't happen. It would be hilarious. But it would be weird if that didn't happen because here's the thing. In nature, the way God created it, is that as you grow, you grow. And as you grow inside, as you grow roots down, you grow in your relationship with God, the evidence of that should be clear in your life and you should be growing. And that's how God designed it. But spiritual growth is not always a given. It doesn't just like in nature, in your physical body, you don't have to do anything to grow. When you're 7 years old, you just eat, you know, and you play, and you grow. And soon you're 9 years old, and you're 12 years old, and like your body, you grow. But in the spiritual world, that does not happen like that. You do not just mysteriously grow with no intention. Yes, we mature, and we gain life experience, and there's some aspect to that. But in general, spiritually, we don't just grow. Not just by sitting around and being a part of God's church. We don't just naturally, without intention, grow. Let me share with you from God's word in Luke chapter 8. Jesus shares a really helpful story when it comes to this concept of spiritual growth and the different ways that we can encounter it, the different ways we can experience it. Luke chapter 8, beginning in verse 5. He says, a farmer went out to sow his seed, and as he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and it was trampled on, and the birds ate it up. Some fell on rocky ground, and when it came up, the plants withered because they had no moisture. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up with it and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, and it came up, and it yielded a crop 100 times more than was sown. It's a really interesting story. Jesus is teaching a crowd, but then he goes on like he often does, and he goes back and he explains what he meant by this story. If you jump down to verse 11, you catch the explanation. He says, the seed is the word of God. Those along the path are the ones who hear, and then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts so that they may not believe and be saved. Those on the rocky ground are the ones who receive the word with joy when they hear it, but they have no root. They believe for a while, but in the time of testing, they fall away. The seed that fell among the thorns stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by life's worries, riches, and pleasures, and they do not mature. But the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart who hear the word and retain it, and by persevering, produce a crop. And Jesus gives us an example of these four different soils. The path, which represents the hard heart the devil destroys, or the rocky soil with no roots, and in the time of testing, it falls away. Or the seed that falls among the thorns and it's choked out by life's worries, riches, and pleasures. But then he says there's this fourth seed, which I hope will be you and I. He says that falls among the good soil and it grows over time. It grows over time. And here's the takeaway from all this. It's in your notes. Here's the lesson. Good intentions and fresh commitments fade fast if not supported. Good intentions and fresh commitments, they fade fast if not supported, and not supported by the good soil. See, support significantly helps us sustain change and growth in our life. You know, we need to bring others into the loop. That's one of the great things about being a part of a church and being here consistently and being in community and getting to know people and taking that effort to get involved in serving or connecting in a group. And because you get these relationships and you have all these growth partners in your life that can help you. And two, the support also is not only just in the form of people, but I think it's in some ways it's in the systems of our lives, in the rhythms of our lives, in the currents of our lives. And how we live, things we do to help sustain that growth. And I'm going to come back to that. So how do we keep growing? How do we keep growing? Let's look back at Psalm chapter 1 again, another illustration from nature that we're given that's so helpful. I love Psalm chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree." Listen, it's like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. So it gives us this analogy again of this tree that's healthy and it's planted along the riverbank and the water's nourishing the root system. And so it grows up and it's healthy and it's producing fruit because there is health there. You know, the contrast between the growing believer and the wicked person is so stark, it's so clear. And it talks about how there's a huge difference because the righteous person, part of the growth in our lives is we avoid wickedness. We avoid evil, and we pursue God, and we pursue good. And I want to encourage you not to be overwhelmed when you look at your life and you see the need for change. Because all of us, from time to time, we take a step back and we look at our lives and we take a snapshot and we're thinking, man, there's so much that needs to grow. There's so much that's not healthy that I want to be healthy. There's so much that is withered and I want to see it fresh and producing fruit. There's so much that is no longer vibrant or never was vibrant, and I want it to be different. And I want to encourage you to just take one step at a time. It's like building a foundation. You put one block on top of another block, and sometimes that growth is progressive, and it unlocks other kinds of growth in your life. And so the principle I see is that we have to keep pursuing growth, keep growing, keep taking steps to grow closer to God, and with every step we continue to grow, and the Holy Spirit will show you what's next. You just do what he shows you to do now, and you take that step, and you grow today, and then tomorrow you'll have another challenge, and you'll grow then. Jesus said, don't worry about tomorrow. Every day has enough worries of its own. So what do you need to do today? Where do you need to grow today? And I think the question that we should never stop asking, it's in your notes, is simply this. Where do I need pruning? And where could I see progress? Where do I need pruning? What needs to be cut back in my life? And where do I need to see progress, growth, change? Once or twice a month, I go out to my little tropical garden in my house, and I love being out there, and I'll go out the trimmers, and I'll go to the palm trees, and I'll cut back the branches that are now sagging that need to be cut back, and I'll go to the plants that have leaves that are now the old branches, and I'll take them at the stem, and I'll cut them and clip them off, and I'm done, I'll have a big old pile of branches that have been cut back and need to be thrown out. When you make that cut at the point where it connects with the core of the branch, everything from that cut outward eventually will die because you've disconnected it from its source. And the amazing thing about Jesus is that when he comes into our life, he attacks the source, which is sin, and he destroys that, and he brings a new source in our life of hope, a new source of life-giving blood pumping through our veins, and that's the hope of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of our sins, but not only the forgiveness of our past sins, the power to overcome sin in the future and to live free from wickedness and instead to live a righteous life, a life that's God-honoring, and he honors and blesses those who honor him, and so he pours in new life, and there's growth, and there's fruit, and there's productivity and progress, and all these things come into our life when the source is healthy. I heard one person describe it like sin is like the creeper vines. you know, that you'll sometimes see growing up on the sides of buildings or on trees. And if you cut the base of those creeper vines, they're going to remain for a while. They'll stay on there unless you physically pull them off. But over time, they will disintegrate and die. And that's because you've cut them off at the point where they are the strongest. You've cut them off at the base. And as God comes in and he reshapes the foundation of your life, you might still see the residual of your past. You might still remember the things that you used to do or the ways you used to live, and others might taunt you with it and say, yeah, you're trying to change. That's not you. I know who you really are. And listen, that's the devil. He's trying to discourage you. You're no longer that person. See, the base has been cut off of your who you used to be. The Bible says the old is gone, the new has come. Jesus has brought new life into you. And so you might see the residual for a time, but listen, Jesus has changed the game when you've given your life to him. And everything from here on will change. So where do I need pruning in my life? Where do I need to see some progress? What needs to change? What needs to change? Maybe you want to take a moment right now and just jot that down. Maybe make a note. You know, what is it in my life? Maybe I need to schedule an appointment to sit down and pray and think about what needs to change in my life. Where do I need to see progress? So getting a vision for the what that needs to change is so important in our lives. The what is so important. But behind the what and to make the what happen, there's a how. How we change. How we grow. How we mature. And that's so important. You know, behind every what, there's a how. Everything, even the simple things in life, even the fun things of life. You know, we just watched this fun video and we saw these little babies dancing, and what a cool thing. And, you know, that's a what. That's fun. But even behind that what, there was a how, like a how it happened, how it was made. Check it out. Saw the what, and maybe you didn't give much thought to it. You're like, oh, that was cool. But then you're like, wow, there's a lot of how that went into the what, and like how they did that. That took a lot of effort. That took a lot of planning. That's true in life. You know, sometimes you look at someone like, man, I wish I had their character. I wish I lived like that, or I could do this or change that. Man, I see it over here, and you see the what, but you don't realize that that's backed by a whole lot of how. You know, you look at this great palm tree, you know, and you look at this maybe some fruit tree that's mature and producing fruit, but you forget that at one time that fruit tree used to be just a little seed in the soil. It was just a thought. It was just an idea that had not even grown up out of the soil yet. It was hidden. It was obscure. But then at one point it broke through the dirt and just looked like a little branch sticking up out of the soil. And then over time it grew and matured, but it didn't have fruit yet. But eventually one day it grew to the point that you see it and you're like, that's a great what? Well, it had a whole history of how. And in your life, if you just focus on the what and you don't have a how, you'll always be frustrated. And you'll never get to your potential where you want to go. And so what's the how? How do we grow? We know we need to grow spiritually. We've identified areas that need to change. How do we grow? How do we change? How do we progress? Well, maybe you missed it. Back in Psalm chapter 1, verse 2, we're actually given an amazing how. Verse 2, Psalm chapter 1. He's talking about this blessed person that avoids wickedness and all that. But then he goes on and says, this person, someone who delights in the law of the Lord and who meditates on his law day and night. He goes on to say, that person is like the tree planted along the riverbank that's healthy and nourished. You know, they're in God's word. They have the truth in their life, and that truth exposes the lies. You know, the Word of God is so powerful. It's so productive in our lives, and I just put it this way in your notes. We grow spiritually by making daily investments, and maybe you want to circle that word daily investments says night and day, daily investments in God's word. That's the first how. That's the first tool for us, making daily investments in spiritual preparation to help us reach our God-given potential through investing in God's word. That will change your life. That has changed my life over and over again. One of my mentors, Dan Ryland, he said, whatever I'm doing today is preparing me for tomorrow. All tomorrow does is give me a readout of what I'm doing today. And what I am today is what I prepared for yesterday. So success is not a destination thing, it's a daily thing. What are you doing daily to invest in the how of becoming the what God wants you to be? What are you doing to see transformation in your life? And I'm going to put this verse on the screen for you, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. This is in the Message paraphrase and just says it in such a fresh way. I just thought this would be helpful. It says, Hebrews 4, 12, God means what he says. What he says goes. His powerful word is sharp as a surgeon's scalpel, cutting through everything, whether doubt or defense, laying us open to listen and obey. You know, the amazing thing about God's word is that when we open it, it opens us. And it's like being laid on a surgeon's table. And the lights are shining down on you, and they make the incision, and they get inside, and that's exactly what God's word does. It says it lays us open. You know, it exposes the lies in us that we've bought into from our culture and from our world. The lies that the devil's baited out there for us and we've hooked onto without realizing it. As we read God's word, it exposes, it shines light on those things into the dark corners of our heart that you can hide from the people around you and even the people you live with, but you cannot hide from the person who lives inside you. And it exposes those things in your life. It shines a light on them. It changes you, causes you to grapple with what real truth is. And it just does so much. But it's not, see, here's the thing. It's not about a checklist. This is not another religious activity. You say, well, I need to read the Bible today, and I need to check that box. That's not it at all. In fact, great pastor and author John Ortberg, he said, God's primary goal is not for you to get all the way through the Bible. It's for the Bible to get all the way through you. See, God wants it to get inside you and bring about transformation. I love James 1:22. It says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves, but do what it says. So in other words, it's not about information, right? It's about transformation. It's about what God wants to do in your life and through your life. And as he brings his word into you, it transforms you. One amazing author, he said this. He said, great literature, what it does is it transforms the condition of the person who's reading it to be more like the condition of the person who wrote it. And as God delivers his word to us and we read it and we're exposed to it, it changes our lives. It changes our perspective. I want to give you a challenge today, and it is a massive challenge. I mean, the bar is incredibly high. I'm not like lowering the bar, and let's just see like if you. I mean, it's a really high bar, and it's just whoever wants to take it. But I'm just throwing out a really significant challenge. But I believe if just a handful of people took this challenge, it will change their lives. The challenge that I want to serve up to you is one that I accepted when I was a sophomore in high school. I grew up in a Christian home, so I was around the Bible. We probably had a handful of them on any given shelf in our house at any point, and I was familiar with it, and I went to church, and I heard teaching on the Bible. But when I was a sophomore in high school, 16, maybe 17 years old, I could drive, had my fresh driver's license, and went out and drove down to, for some reason, God clearly prompted me, but went out to the local family Christian store and went inside, and I found a new Bible. And a Bible of my own, and wrote my name in it. And I got a devotional book, and I took those, and I went home, and I was an athlete, and I played sports in school, and so I knew what it meant to train and to have a training program. And so I said, you know what I'm going to do is I'm going to do like I would anything else. I'm going to train myself to be more like Jesus. And that's when I really started to own my faith. It became my faith, not my parents' faith. And I went out, and I said, I'm going to read the Bible every single day for a year. That was my goal. And I was intense about it. I'm like, I'm gonna try. I was like, I'm gonna see if I can go a whole year to read the Bible. And I was just that youthful enthusiasm, and that excitement. And you know how it is when you make a fresh commitment. Man, you jump into it and those first few steps are easy. You're running down the path, but then it gets hard, And I made it like 9 months. And one night I was really tired and I fell asleep before I read my Bible, and the next day I was so mad because I'm like, oh, I made it this far, and I didn't make it to my goal. But you know what? It wasn't about, you know, exactly what I was doing. It was how God was changing me in that process, and my young mind was being transformed, and I was starting to see things from a different perspective, and God was shaping me. And I went on, it took me a while, maybe a few years, but I eventually made it an entire year, 365 days, and read the Bible every day. And I realized now, looking back on it, like that was a gift that God gave me to get me into His Word, to transform my mind, and to take me down a different path than what I could down, what some of my peers went down. And I'm so grateful for that investment of God's Word in my life and how it changed me. And I still do that to this day. I'm still digging for God's Word. I'm still searching out God's Word every day, trying to learn how I can grow and be more like Him. Because I want to change, and here's my challenge for you, is to do that exact thing and read the Bible every single day for the next 365 days. It's hard to do something hundreds of times in a row, but you can do it. You already do it. You brush your teeth every day. I hope you do. You brush your teeth every day. That's something you've trained yourself to do. You eat every day. You sleep every day. There's rhythms in your life that are very good and healthy for you. And this is the most important thing you can do. Expose yourself more to God and allow Him to change you and transform you. You can do that. But it'll take you making a plan and then walking that path, which is difficult and it's not easy. And maybe you'll shoot for 7 and hit 5, but it'll be a lot better than whatever maybe is going on for you now. But that'll start to change you. And then you want more of it. And you realize, man, God, Your Word is changing me. And there's a lot of different ways you can do it. In fact, maybe you'd want to go ahead and get on the Growth Steps page of our Church Experience website. And if you go down to this Experiencing Growth step, you see we've linked a Bible reading plan that we customly created. And you can go through for 2 years a Bible reading plan, and you could just print off that PDF, and you could print that off and save it and put it in the Bible or something or on your bedstand. And it doesn't matter if you do it in the morning or in the evening. You find a spot that works for you, and just read it every day. And in a two-year period, you can read through all the New Testament and some major books of the Old Testament by just reading a little bit every day. A paragraph or a few paragraphs every day, you can do that in 2 years. You can read through the whole New Testament, a lot of the Old Testament, or you can double your reading, and in a two-year period, you can read for just a little bit longer, and you can read through the entire Bible in 2 years. If you want, you can read about 3 chapters a day, and you can read through the entire Bible in a year. You can take maybe 10 minutes a day or so, and you can read through the Bible. You can do what I do. Most times now, I listen to the Bible. You can get a phone app, Bible Gateway, YouVersion, and, man, you can go on a walk. You can sit in bed and do it. You can do it while you're working out, running on the treadmill, or whatever you're doing. Like, and you can just put it on, and you can listen to the Word of God, and just several chapters can roll through your mind, and you can just learn and grow. I mean, so easily that you can access God's Word and let it change you. But I want to challenge you with this thought from Charles Spurgeon, who is this amazing preacher from centuries ago. He said, you know, nobody outgrows Scripture. Nobody ever outgrows God's Word. It says, the book widens and it deepens with our years. It widens and it deepens with our years. This last week, my 2-year-old daughter climbed up on my lap. And I'm sitting at my desk doing some work, and she climbed up in my lap, cuddled up with Daddy, and I'm holding her there and trying to get something done. And I look over, and she's got this big cracker in her hand, and she's taking a little nibble out of it. Well, my kids know, even our 2-year-old, they know that when you snack, which they love to snack, that they're supposed to do it at the table. Because mom and dad don't want to clean crumbs up from all around the house. So we say, if you're eating, you got to go eat at the table. And so I see the cracker, and I'm enjoying holding her, and she's enjoying sitting there. But I'm like, honey, you gotta go to the table in the kitchen. And she knew exactly what I was saying. She's almost 3, and she looks up at me, and she looks at this cracker that's mostly uneaten. And I know what she's thinking. She's like, I don't want to leave Daddy, but I want to eat this cracker. And so instead of going to the kitchen table, you know what she did? She took that whole cracker with several bites, and she just go right in her mouth. And just put the whole thing in her mouth. Just ate it in one bite. She's like, so now I'm not eating anymore. No crumbs. I can stay in Daddy's lap, you know. And she's like, I'm willing to give up this food experience so that I can just have this time with Daddy. And you know what? For you to get more time with your Father, you will have to give up something in order for you to get up in His presence and get more time with Him. You will have to lay down some things so you can pick up some better things. And in your life, you will always be busy. You're gonna find some things, and this world will put some things in your life and in your lap that will fill your time. And you can constantly be filled with busyness, or you can get around God and you can fill your life with things that will actually transform and change you. And I'm just saying, you'll never find time time. You will never find time. Some people, I can't find time, man. I'm so busy. I have kids. I have two jobs. I'm trying to do this. I'm trying to do that. I don't know how I can do it all. Listen, I get it. We're all busy. You'll never find time. You have to carve out time. You have to make time for the things that matter most. And this is it, getting around God's word. But that's not the only tool. If you're writing these down, we grow spiritually by daily investing in prayer. In prayer. Investing time and daily talking with God, and developing that friendship with Him, that companionship. And this is one of the greatest gifts. This is the greatest gift in life. And we were singing earlier, and I was like, it just doesn't get better than this. Like thinking about life eternal with my Father in heaven, and we will rise again, all those things we just sang. It's like, that. It doesn't get better than that. There's no greater gift. Like the companionship and friendship with God, forgiveness of our sins, we get to walk with Him, experience His presence. That's what prayer is. It's getting around God, spending time with Him. So the tool of growing closer to God is spending time in His Word daily, and I'm going to give you a challenge to do that every day. And then I want to challenge you to pray. I'm not talking about casual, before mealtimes and bedtime prayer, in crisis, God, I need help. All that's great in a part of our prayer life, but I'm talking about carving out some time to talk with God, to spend time with Him, to grow in your relationship with Him. And here's the thing, there's more for you than what you've discovered yet of God. There is. No one in this room, none of us have tapped out God. It's not like that some of us have got to a certain place spiritually with God and we're like, I got God figured out. I don't need to spend any more time with Him because I got it. So I'm good. It's like we never get my oldest son, Jalen, has been to this specific beach in North Carolina, Holden Beach, North Carolina, where we meet up with family every year. He's been there every single year of his life. The 9 years he's grown up, and then the 1 year he was an infant, a newborn, he's literally been to that same spot on the beach every year of his life, for the last 10 years. This last summer, we were there, and he was digging the sand with all the cousins, finding some seashells, and he found a shark tooth in the sand. Now, all other 9 years, no one had ever found a shark tooth. We've always looked for shells and things, and he found this shark tooth. And it was a good one. We were looking at it like, we didn't know you could find shark teeth here. I know down in Venice Beach in Florida, you go further south there, you can go down there, you can find shark teeth early in the morning, it can happen. We didn't know that you could find them there. And everyone's like, wow, that's amazing. And that night, Jennifer's dad looked it up and found out that just further north of us there, that there's some beaches that are really well known for having shark teeth. So they're in the area. It's a thing that you can find. And so I guarantee you the next summer, the next time we're at that beach, he's going to go and all the cousins, and instead of just looking for shells this time, you know what they're going to do? They're going to be digging in that sand, and they're going to be looking for shark teeth because they know something is there now that they didn't think was there before. They're looking for something that they didn't realize was there, and they're going to dig and try to find what they now know is available for them. And until you realize, until you understand that God has more for you, that you dig down in that well of God's love, until you dig down in that well of God's friendship and realize that there's more for you, you won't go looking for it. And I'm just saying there's more of God than you have discovered yet. And if you will lean into that and you will press into your relationship with God and find time for Him, you will grow in ways that you've never grown before. And this is an amazing tool for you to grow spiritually. It's time with God. So how does that happen? Well, man, it's real simple. It's really like any relationship. A good friendship, dating companionship, a marriage. Maybe you get a growth partner like I'm talking about and you find someone to grow with you. Any relationship, there's two things. It's how you grow. Just from my experience, this is how any relationship, it's spontaneous times together. It's just hanging out. The courage to, you know, share what's going on in your life. Hey, here's what's up. Here's what I'm struggling with. The vulnerability of that and here's what I'm, you know, anxious about, I'm worried about, I'm concerned about, I'm praying about, here's what's happening in my life, here's the cool things, and you celebrate together, hey, I'm really excited about this is what's happening in my life, and you're sharing, hey, how's it going, you're talking and you're listening, it's this conversation that's happening, that's how you grow, but then it's not just the spontaneous times, it's the scheduled times, that's the other way, spontaneous times, there's the scheduled times. Right? So if you're married, you know, you're dating somebody, you put it on the calendar. Hey, Friday night, we're going to go on a date. You got kids, man, we can hardly afford it. We're going to have to take a picnic to a park, but we're going to get time alone. So we're going to, the few bucks we have towards a babysitter, and we're going to go out and we're going to schedule time because we need that time together. Or if it's a bunch of girls, hey, let's get a ladies' night out. Let's go out. Let's spend some time together. Let's go hang out. Let's just go hit the beach. Let's just hang out. We need to spend, it's been a while since we've had some time together. You got a buddy. You call him. Hey, man, you want to go fishing? And you're sitting out there, and it's not about the friendship. You put that on the calendar to go fishing, but it's not about the fishing. It's about the friendship. And you're sitting there, and you're hanging out, and you're talking. You know, it is actually about the fish. Okay. And you're hanging out. And you know, you get some stories, and you got some pictures. Look what we caught together. And it's like, it's those moments that memories are made in. So you have the spontaneous, and you have the scheduled. And I'm just saying, in your relationship with God, I think from just seeing how I feel like I've been growing, like I think it's like that. It's like I'm trying to bring God more into my day spontaneously. And you're always busy, but it's breaking from busy and saying, okay, God, hey, so this is what's going on right now. Our Holy Spirit, please lead me. I'm trying to figure this out. Help me out. It's just pushing back from whatever you got that you're working on, and it's maybe taking a quick walk or finding a quiet space or a quiet moment when you wake up in the morning or first thing when you start your day or at the end of the day, and it's just finding a space spontaneously to talk to God and say, God, here's what's happening. And I'm learning more and more to not just talk to God, but to say, Holy Spirit, speak to me. And I know you're in me. The Bible tells me that. And so your presence is with me. And so I'm just going to not talk right now, and I'm just going to listen. And I'm just going to kind of rest in your presence. It says in the Bible, be still and know that I'm God. And I'm just going to kind of say, God, speak to me. And I think that God impresses on your heart, you know, and he brings things to mind that maybe that you're missing. And I think that's one of the ways we grow. So it's spontaneous, but it's scheduled too. I can tell you when I'm going to spend time reading the Bible today. I've done this for years, and sometimes consecutively for years, I've just every single day, like meeting with God, I just know it's a part of my rhythm. It's kind of it's as consistent as brushing my teeth. Every single day, I'm going to do it. This time, I'm going to spend time with God. I'm going to read the Bible, and I'm going to pray, and I have some things I do to help me grow closer to God. I'm just going to do that, and I know when. And you can kind of carve that out. I know when I'm going to have some more serious times of prayer this week. There'll be a couple days this week where I'm just breaking from my normal, just kind of praying, and I'm going to like just carve out some significant, serious time where I'm just going to just hang out with God, kind of like you would schedule a time to go hang out with a fishing buddy or a meeting for work. I'm putting it on the calendar. I just kind of know I'm doing that. And that's how I'm growing. And if that helps you, I think it's a great tool for us to grow in our relationship with God. And I hope you'll be praying for the people around you like we did the 21 days of prayer and we prayed for each other. I hope you're praying for each other. I hope you're praying for your leaders here at Church Experience and those who are serving and setting up and making things happen. I hope you'll pray. I hope you'll pray for our community that the spiritually lost will be found and be changed. I mean, God, there's so much that God wants to do through prayer, but here's the point. It's the last point in your notes. Good plans help reinforce important changes. So what's my plan? Good plans reinforce important changes. So what's my plan? What is your plan? I hope you'll leave here with a plan or that you'll carve out some time to go and pray and get a plan. Joe Frazier, this is what he said about plans. He said, you can map out a fight plan or a life plan, but when the action starts, it may not go the way that you planned, and you're down to your reflexes. That means your preparation. That's where your road work shows. If you cheated in the dark of the morning, well, you're going to get found out under the bright lights. Champions do not become champions in the ring. They are merely recognized in the ring. Their becoming happens in their daily routine. And I would say the daily routine is what shapes spiritual champions. People who are living for God and honoring him and making a great difference for him, that are healthy, that are growing and producing fruit for God's kingdom. I think that comes when we give God our daily lives and we're in his word and we're praying and we're growing. That's how growth happens. It changes our current reality into God's possibility through those daily steps. It's making a plan, walking a path, making a plan, walking a path. It's the same in any area of your life. In a New Year's Day, half of us are going to make some kind of health commitment, right? And we're going to say, man, I'm going to go out to the gym, or I'm going to run. I'm going to do some exercise. I'm going to swim 5 times a week, and I'm going to get healthy. And so you make a plan, but then you also have to walk the path, because if February 1st, most of us, we have long since forgotten the commitment to do whatever, however many times. And it's because you have to not just make a plan, you have to walk the path. You say, I'm going to start eating healthy. Okay, that's a great thing. I'm going to start eating healthy. I'm going to get away from all those greasy foods. I'm going to stop eating so much sweets and stay away from the dessert table. I love it. I'm going to, whatever my deal is, that I'm going to eat healthy. I'm making my plan. But then you also have to stick to your plan, and you have to, when it's there in front of you, you have to stick with your plan, and you have to walk out that path. And so spiritually, you can make a plan, but you also have to walk the path, and that's how you grow. And so if you leave here and you want to grow spiritually closer to God, you have some great tools: getting in God's word, spending time with God, developing that friendship with him. But you have to not only make a plan, you have to walk a path. And tonight before you go to bed, you have to walk that path. And tomorrow when you wake up, you have to walk that path. And for this to grow in your life, the next day you're going to have to walk the path. And when it gets hard, you're going to have to still walk that path. And when you have adversity or difficulty, you have to still walk that path. So you can't just make a plan, you have to walk the path, but you need a good plan. And so for us to grow spiritually, God has laid out for us in his word. He said, hey, here's the plan. You just walk the path and stay close to me, and I will help you grow in your relationship with me, and your life will never be the same. Right on?
We hope you got a lot out of today's teaching and we'll be able to apply it to your everyday life. Again, if you'd like to learn more, get connected, or begin to give financially, just check out the link below. Thanks for stopping by, and we hope to see you real soon.